Section 11, The Last Solar Bastion Titan. When Terra fell, spewing warp stuff and corrupted fleets of pilgrims out from it in all directions, many worlds were unprepared. Luna was suddenly struck by millions upon millions of wild-eyed maniacs, who crashed their very captured transports into the Lunar Fortress, which was unprepared for an attack from Terra itself. Many of the other Imperial emplacements, built upon asteroids and various other celestial bodies within the solar system, were overwhelmed by the insane screaming demons, which invaded the Vox traffic of the entire solar system. These facilities collapsed, as their now insane human workers and rulers opened airlocks, ruptured plasma drives, and generally fought each other with broken, bloodied nails, and improvised cudgels. Heaven Forest, the Ramillies class star fought orbiting Sedna, plunged into the icy planetoid, killing everyone on the planet and the fortress. Desperate fleets of evacuated officials and dignitaries escaped on requisitioned transports and embattled troop transports and grain ships. The Ecclesiarch, flanked by an entire lesser order of Sisters of Battle, captured the cruiser Lestat, for himself and his nearest clergy, before his new vessel led the retreat out of Terra. Leading over 100,000 ragtag ships from the cradle of mankind, a single Imperial Fist Thunderhawk was said to have escaped too, docking with a fleeing bulk freighter. The Astartes aboard had been given a simple order by their captain, which they were told to reiterate to any and all Imperial Fists and Fist successors they could find. The message was simple: dig in. While all solar turned to insanity, the Grey Knights took a different path. They instantly, as soon as Terra fell, shut off all Vox transmissions, and refused to respond to any hails, believing that the demons could infest Titan even through electrical signals. The vast wave of psychic madness that pulsed from Terra in sickening waves rebounded from Titan, like water breaking around an ocean bulwark. This precious sanity allowed the vast number of human personnel living upon Titan to organize defense against the marauding, insane former pilgrims, who threw themselves upon any worlds they could find. Their ships were blasted from the sky systematically by the vast automatic guns of Titan. Ancient weapons, deep beneath the surface, bubbled upwards from the methane lakes of Titan, shooting down anything that the psychic Grey Knights believed was corrupted. When the vast ship bearing the custodes entered Titan's orbit, it too was nearly shot down by Titan's deadly defenses. Even the ancient Cassini device, the vast spidery construct that it was, powered up its utterly lethal plasma lance, and trained it upon the wayward vessel. The Grey Knights of course ordered them to all stand down, when the two Grand Masters present upon the moon detected the golden, perfect light of the Adeptus custodes aboard the vessel. Once the custodes were safely landed upon the freezing planetoid, the chief custodian marched directly to the central fortress of Titan, and demanded to speak with the Grand Masters in private. The meeting lasted for several days. Nobody knows what was said between the two forces. Secrets were exchanged between the two ancient organizations, secrets accumulated by both institutions over the course of many millennia of service, and plans were drawn up. Eventually, they emerged, and the defense could begin in earnest. Fortunately for Titan, the inquisitorial forces around the rest of Saturn and Jupiter's moons had also managed to somehow avoid annihilation, and they flocked to the most defensible world, Titan itself. The Inquisitors met with the custodes and Astartes leadership, and they agreed on methods of defense. Vast galleries beneath Titan were cleared of ancient relics, devotional artifacts and tapestries. And the Inquisitors brought all the fusion-powered lamps and artificial lighting they could muster from their own bases, and installed them as quickly as possible. The Ordo Xenos brought with them cultures for rapid plant and microbial growth, and special species of flora, which could survive on heat and light alone, and under the heavy lights. They were implanted into these vast, multiple-mile-long halls, which soon began to seethe with succulent, life-sustaining material. The Ordo Hereticus that remained around the solar system brought with them all their psychopathic cyborgs, from Chrono Gladiators to Arco-Flagellants, from Penitent Engines to the colossal excruciating machines, tower-sized machines of gears and chains, which constantly tortured heretical sickers within their workings, sending out waves of warding protection and powerful anti-sicker energies. Malus brought all the various forbidden tomes it could salvage from the ruins of the data repositories, along with all the null rods and various anti-demon weapons and devices they could pull from the besieged ruins. The entire first edition of the Grimoire of True Names was brought to Titan, bound in heavy chains, and carried by a veritable army of loyal cultists. Such was its vast size. There, it was safely stored within the central bastion, under heavy guard. Every name of every demon thus far encountered by the Imperium was stored within that most mighty of tomes. The devotional and holy relics, cleared from the underground areas, were placed into the upper halls. It was said one could not turn their head without seeing a beautiful image of the Emperor, or great gilded statues, which glimmered with psychic resonance. Battlefield engineers, and the scant few tech priests upon Titan, began to plan and devise the extra fortification of Titan. Bunker construction instructions, cultivated from Cardia and other such heavily fortified worlds, were taken out and implemented. Overlapping avenues of fire and perfectly positioned bunkers and trench works were bored into the surface of Titan by the countless millions of toiling humans and astartes upon the world. Several Imperial Fist Death Watch, under the instructions of the Ordo Xenos Inquisitors, advised and helped with the fortifications, ensuring they were impregnable and immortal. Soon, these defenses were put to the test. A vast greater demon, Vorchoch the Maker, led a vast surge of demons from the demon world of Terra. Huge demon engines and vessels were built from the mutated and semi-sentient ruins of Terra. Ships made from masonry and fallen fragments of old Terra were fused together by demon flesh, which formed unnatural ribs, tentacles and snouts, which pulsed and writhed throughout the demonic structures. These ruined ships were alive with demonic hatred, and crawled with billions of demonic beasts, which scuttled through the orifice-like passages of the vessels like lice. The fleet spread across the solar system, killing all those humans who evaded initial extermination up until then. Eventually, only Titan remained. The aura of psychic defense around Titan was immense, and it shone, as if an imitation of the now extinct Astronomicon itself. Demon vessels howled as they entered the halo of unseen magical wards and psychic barriers. Some of the ruined ships came apart at that moment, as the demon princes powering their central cores were weakened so much, they were banished from reality almost instantly. Of course, the majority were far too powerful to simply die, and they barreled through regardless. Many more of the weakened demon ships were destroyed by the ancient Cassini device and the other defense satellites that blasted their ruins to ash. Under the barrage of lasers and blinding flashes of the deadly plasma lance of the Cassini, which shimmered from the device's vast hyperbolic mirror projector. Yet still, many of the demonically possessed structures managed to evade destruction and entered the dense orange atmosphere of Titan. The defense lasers and atomic railguns of Titan spewed death into the hateful beasts. Nevertheless, the beasts were not of mortal matter, and the ruined vessels crashed, allowing their demonic cargo to drag themselves from the wreckage and flood towards the stout defenders. The holy ground of Titan burned the demons as they swarmed across the hallowed lands. The human defenders were embattled, and many of them died, torn apart or burned by the abhorrent monstrosities, which howled and screamed in delight and agony. However, every single defender of Titan wielded blessed weapons, anointed and thrice blessed with holy oils and wards glinting with brilliant holy sheen. Lasgan spat death, the physical light of the beams merging with the spiritual light, which poured from the defenders themselves. The blazing furnace of insane piety produced by the defenders filled the demons with agony and vaporizing pain. The humans of Titan believed they were the last humans in all the universe. They would not die, they cursed with their upraised voices, until their lungs were raw and bloody. They did not fear, but instead promised themselves to their own god. They must survive, and they would not be destroyed by this filth. The Grey Knights, their blades blazing with white angel light, waded amongst the demons, hacking down the corrupt horrors with every swing of their blessed glaives. The Golden Custodian joined in battle with their silver counterparts. The Custodians fought with the fury of madmen, tears streaming in their eyes, as they screamed in grief turned to hatred. The Chief Custodian himself, engaged in battle with Vorchoch itself. The Titanic Demon was as large as a Titan, formed from the fused hulks of 100 dreadnoughts, 1,000 tanks, and many thousands of cadavers, all animated by the beast's dreadful will. In place of its face, a terrible blasphemy was perpetrated. The husk of the Emperor, the dried out, dead husk, was fused with the Demon King. Of course, nothing of the Emperor resided within the corpse now, but the heresy was beyond comprehension. The Chief Custodian lost his mind, his righteous hatred overriding his conscious mind. He surged forwards, hacking aside everything in his way, and engaged in epic conflict with the abhorrence that wore the Emperor's face. The Custodian, mounting the countless bodies of the battle, scaled the demon, battling every tendril, every talon, which it swung at him. He was a blur of golden light, hacking and slashing with furious abandon. The battle lasted 3 full days, as more and more custodes and Grey Knights drew themselves towards the conflict. Silver-armored Grey Knights pumped gallons of blessed promethium onto the horrific colossus, as others charged its giant legs, hacking chunks from the monster with furious, frenzied hacks with their glaives, before pumping bolter rounds into the wounds. The custodians joined them, stabbing and shooting at everything they could see of the horror. And, from deep beneath Titan's surface, 10 dark figures joined the conflict, unseen by their colleagues. At the height of the battle, the chief custodian was devoured whole, the vast jaws of the greater demon opening to engulf him, even as he roared defiance. The battle drew on for another day, as every spare defender turned their weapons upon the abomination. Brother Captain Stern, wielding his force sword in 2 hands, managed to hack the Emperor's shriveled corpse free of the demon, and it was borne away by sobbing priests and hissing, angry inquisitors. On the 7th day, the demon shuddered, and then collapsed, dead and banished. The defenders were baffled by this, until, a few hours later, the chief custodian cut his way free. Drenched in black demon blood, and with his armor buckled and broken, he raised his left hand, from which dangled the putrid heart of the demon king. The demons wailed in misery and fury, but still they came, the warp stuff spilling over itself, so eager was it to harm, maim and slaughter their ancient foes. The demons were just as driven as the defenders. If they could destroy Titan, they need never fear banishment by them ever again. The war drew on, and many died, as the air was alive with fire, blood and endless, deafening screams. On one corner of Titan, a group of Terminators began to sing their litanies of hate, their holy battle hymn, which would unleash their faith in one grand torrent. However, the mundane humans, and the custodes, and even the inquisitors, began to join in, even as the battle dragged on. They did not, however, unleash their furious wrath upon completing the hymn, but instead merely began to chant and repeat it, over and over. Through word of mouth and overhearing, the hymn passed across all of Titan, until it was as if the whole world was chanting the litanies as one. Though the words were gotten wrong by many of the distant humans, the feeling was the same all over. Titan was theirs, and no others. The whole world seemed incandescent, glowing with brilliant white light, until, after a full day of chanting, the psychic holocaust of Titan was unleashed. It pulsed once, a single wave of psychic magnificence, which rippled across all Titan, and out into the space beyond Titan's orbit. For a brief instance, it was as if Sola had gained a smaller twin of itself, as all Titan flickered once, with this brilliant light, before it eventually faded to nothing once more. Thus ended the first siege of Titan. The defenders dug in again, and for another 100 years, they fought off further demonic attacks, until they stopped entirely, on the dawn of the 43rd millennium. This was because of the Great Beast, which has arisen on the Red Planet. The Void Dragon's Necron fleets, and corrupted Mechanicum vessels, surged from Mars, securing all of the solar system, bar Terra and, inevitably, Titan. Over the years, Titan had become almost intolerable to live upon. The nutrient-rich gruel, formed from the cultures of mulch supplied by the Ordo Xenos, centuries past, was often stagnant, or otherwise tightly rationed. The human forces upon Titan, though loyal and zealous as they had ever been, began to succumb to their own mortal frailties. Diseases were common, and the only defenders that seemed immune to this rot and degradation were the custodes and the Grey Knights. They gave the defenders hope. No matter the horrors of existence, humanity would survive, under the benevolent watch of the immortals. The custodes wasted no time, and bound the Emperor's ruined corpse in scented bandages and silks and other fabrics. Upon his face, a perfect likeness of the Emperor's original visage, belized in gold, was placed over his rotten mess of a real face. And the remaining fragments of his old armor were placed upon him. A perfect golden throne was built for the corpse, and placed in plain sight, upon the very highest ramparts of the central bastion, as a symbol of humanity's will to survive, and will to remake their god, for as long as they lived, the Emperor could never die. It was in 666 M43, that the Void Dragon's armies of Necrons and deluded dragon cultists assaulted Titan for the first time. The advanced fleets of the Machine God Ascendant, battled the extensive orbital defenses of Titan for a full 3 weeks, eventually smashing and destroying each of the starships, orbital gun platforms, and star forts, which orbited the freezing moon. Even the Great Cassini, a device said to have been wrought by the first era humans, long before even the Golden Age, fell, blown apart by the lethal energies of the Dracula-class tomb ships. The largest kind of tomb ship ever made by the Dragon, the heavily armored defense guns, however, could not be overcome by mere naval war. They were too well defended, even for the tomb ships. The corrupted Mechanicus vessels, eager to curry favor with their god, unleashed the most dread weapon the Imperium could ever deploy, Exterminatus. Thus, the vast bombs, filled with the black clouds of the Life Eater virus, fell upon the planetoid. However, the Mechanicus, in their naive arrogance, forgot who had designed Titan's defenses. The Emperor's Inquisitors had been employing Exterminatus upon countless worlds for well over 10,000 years. In that time, of course, they had devised a means to defeat it, in the event of viral assault upon inquisitorial worlds. As soon as the billowing clouds of death began to roll across the endless trench systems of Titan, great vents ground open, across the entire surface of Titan. These devices sucked the heinous fog of unlife down massive underground vents, drawing the vile substance, like pus from a gangrenous wound, deep down, dumping the mixture into the blazing core of Titan itself, burning the virus into damnation. Titan refused to be poisoned, like a petty political rival to a High Lord. This was a warrior world, and it would fight. The Necrons had to land. Myriad were the technological marvels the dragon unleashed upon Titan. From molten Necrons that could not be harmed by any heat weapons, to the Primarch-sized Thunder God Necron constructs, which pulsed with great arcs of lethal electrical power permanently, to vast mechanical swarms of faceless beings that could drag the souls from the body and annihilate them utterly. Yet, the Necrons could never teleport within the psychically defended central fortifications, and thus, the Titanians could not be dislodged so easily. The cold steel cage of faith and military determination managed to prevail, just, against the wonders of the Necron Horde. The dragon determined that, since he should not have Titan, none would ever leave it. Every ship upon Titan was destroyed, and every spaceport or even runway was blasted with azure energies, until they were naught but molten slag. The dragon prepared to unleash apocalypse upon the trapped Titan. However, fortune came from a strange place. Abaddon, by chance, had plunged into the solar system, and had encountered the Void Dragon. Thus, the war which ensued, saved Titan from a cowardly murder by the dragon. Of course, the wars against the Necrons never stopped, but never again did the dragon contemplate blowing Titan to pieces. He had greater concerns. While they had survived, Titan's valiant and unbreakable defenders still suffered. The toxic fumes of war, combined with the increasingly less nourishing floral matter beneath the surface, and the punishing wars against abominations, took their toll upon the human defenders. Almost all of the mundane defenders of Titan were dead within a year, leaving only the Grey Knights and Custodes, alone and lonely, upon their small adamantine sphere of unbreakable strength. They carefully buried each and every mundane human, making their tombs each as grand as possible. The chaplains of the Grey Knights canonized every single fallen human, from infant to old woman, from frail little boy to vibrant, pious girls, each life miserably short. The Grey Knights memorized every face, every name, carving them into their flesh with a morbid determination they always did everything. They would avenge every death, one day. They promised that. Section 12 Warriors of Fortune, Mercenaries in the Second Age of Strife. Chaotic demons and insane monsters were not the sole benefactors of the anarchy inflicted upon the galaxy, in the wake of the twin traumas of being nearly slaughtered wholesale by the new Devourer, and losing the Emperor's guiding light. Hired guns and soldiers for sale preyed upon the misery of the galaxy, like vultures picking at a black, distended eyes of a waterlogged corpse. It is an inevitable part of any war or conflict that these callous, dead-eyed pragmatists would seek to make a swift profit from the anarchy. And, throughout the 10,000 years of strife, these mercenary groups and factions found themselves with an eager market for their services. Thus, these forces, loyal to nothing but profit, were a common sight across the entire breadth of the galaxy. One, the serf soldiery of Krieg. Krieg, a planet of barren toxic deserts and choked, murderous skies, found itself in a terrible predicament during the initial stages of the period. The planet produced no food produce, had very little industry that was not blasted to ruins, or in a permanent state of grim disrepair. With the sudden loss of supplies from the wider Imperium, and a vast population of soldiers, who could not be used for other purposes on their world, it would seem Krieg verged on extinction. However, the problem of so much soldiery would soon become a peculiar advantage to the beleaguered Krieg. The planetary governor of Krieg opened communications with a nearby semi-forge industrial world, Cosentrine, which happened to be in contact with an agri-world, known as Garden Omega Hex. This triad of worlds, each within a few short warp transits of each other, each transit only taking a few months, hatched a plan to save themselves and their direct neighbors. Krieg would reinstigate the previously forbidden force womb procedure, creating ever more soldiers, ever more quickly. These men and women matured swiftly, and from the age of one, they began to be trained in war. Across the vast wastelands of Krieg, these Krieg Marines were equipped by Cosentrine, which churned out massive numbers of lasguns, flak jackets, helmets, artillery, and even a special kind of carapace armor of highest quality. Not to mention other battlefield equipment like shovels, and exported these to Krieg, where the soldiers were outfitted for war. Cosentrine also exported more productive agricultural tools and luxuries to Omega Hex, which in turn exported numerous foodstuffs to both the industrial world complex and to Krieg in order to feed her populace. Of course, these imports were not sufficient to feed both Krieg's civilian populace and the massive numbers of soldiers. Thus, the genius of Krieg's governor, Victor von Kronenberg, came into play. The massive numbers of highly trained, determined and efficient soldiers of Krieg were converted to a new purpose. The death corps of Krieg became the serf soldiery of Krieg. Krieg soldiers were sold to any petty Imperium or Empire Xenos or otherwise that could afford them. After a one-off payment of something valuable that Cosentrine needed, the buying Empire could purchase varying numbers of serf soldiers, anywhere from a couple of squads to an entire fully equipped regiment of Krieg Marines. The serf soldiers, indoctrinated at birth to believe that serfdom and servitude to foreign masters was the highest form of piety, did not question their commercialization. Once sold to the buying empire in question, the triad of Krieg and its neighbors relinquished any responsibility for their soldiers. The empire that bought them has to feed them and look after their new soldiers at their own expense. However, they were worth this price, as the Krieg remained, as ever, excellent soldiers. Thus, by M44, there were examples of Krieg troopers fighting in armies across the entire galaxy, from tyrannical alien warlords' armies of conquest, to the most pious and self-aggrandizing of petty Imperiums. Even the Aphelion Imperium, at some point, purchased Krieg muscle to aid in their second war against Talon. Krieg, the world of war, soon became a world of commercial conflict, growing wealthy and prosperous on the backs of its own self-imposed slave trade, to the Kroot. The Kroot, a race whose biological imperative is to encounter as many diverse opponents as possible, would inevitably retain its mercenary traditions, regardless of increasing TAU pressure to stop this practice. This became more than just a moral issue to the TAU, the bitter TAU, who had seen the older races ruin and despoil so many worlds, believed that the older races did not deserve the galaxy, and enslavement or coerced servitude was the only solution. The mere suggestion of the Kroot actually helping their foes was disgusting and abhorrent to them. However, the Kroot continued this process, sending out war spheres far out into the ever more anarchic galaxy. Soon, this process had to become much more secretive and undercover, as TAU influence expanded beyond and around Peck. The Kroot could not openly dissent, lest they be brought into conflict with the TAU Imperial War Machine. Thus, Kroot were a common sight across the galaxy throughout the period, lending their services to any race willing to permit them to devour the slain, or take a share of the plunder of a successful raid or invasion. Yet, the Kroot could not hope to continue this practice indefinitely. Eventually, several Kroot war parties, returning from a successful war against the Nikuli Republic, were intercepted by TAU patrols and destroyed. This sparked outrage amongst the Kroot, and equal but opposite anger from the TAU High Command, who saw this as evidence of Kroot dissent. In 634 M45, Commander Hawksite, current leader of the westward reaches of the TAU Empire, mobilized an expedition into the Kroot-held worlds. The war lasted almost 2 decades. Forbidden from exterminating the Kroot from orbit by ethereal decree, the commander was forced to engage the Kroot on the ground, on their home worlds of Peck, and the neighboring terraformed worlds. Abundant in Kroot life. The TAU, by this point, had technology almost 7 centuries in advance of the Kroot. Yet, despite this, the Kroot fought a masterful guerrilla war, assaulting the TAU at weak moments, before melting back into the wilderness. The infuriated TAU forces used ever more devastating tactics in a vain attempt to engage the Kroot in open war. The war depleted many resources on both sides and costed many, many lives. Such was the apparent slaughter that many of the ethereal councils of the Inner September Worlds began to call for withdrawal from Peck. After all, they argued, were the Kroot not intended to be allies? Even Ornva became restless over the war. He did not want his forces bogged down in internal conflicts, not when there was an entire galaxy to conquer. Eventually, war broke out between the TAU and their allies, and the Thexan Trade Empire, and their own allies, in the Galactic North. Resources were needed for this war, and thus Ornva ordered withdrawal from Peck, effective immediately. Thus, the Kroot survived. However, what really annoyed Commander Hawksite, was that throughout the entire conflict, the Kroot mercenaries continued to operate, somehow evading TAU patrols. No amount of conflict could prevent the Kroot from spreading themselves throughout the Segmentum, in their quest to biodiversify. Three Janizzar's Freemen. This brutal band of mercenaries had a humble start, deep within the Hexan Imperium, to the Galactic Northwest. They were initially a shipping group, a private company of merchants, who had maintained a fleet of transports. When the galaxy suddenly shattered into rival groupings, they offered their services to the Hexan Imperium. This was a particularly weak Imperium, which hadn't the military power to requisition the Freemen's cargo fleet, and thus the Freemen could charge whatever they wanted, and became rather wealthy. However, due to the lack of military protection provided by the Hexans, the Freemen, under the sickening mutancy of the fleet-based enterprise, Janizzar, hired soldiers to protect them from piracy and rival post-imperial shipping companies. Eventually, the Freemen discovered that they could get far more money from helping to fight in conflicts across the sectors, and perhaps even beyond. Thus, ever more former naval frigates, captured Xenos craft, and converted cargo ships, were purchased from diverse entrepreneurs. Janizzar's Freemen became infamous across a dozen sectors, as brutal and cold mercenaries, loyal to no one but themselves. They hired professional killers and soldiers from a wide range of backgrounds. Orphaned Imperial Guardsmen and Stormtroopers, former Rogue Trader staff, now penniless and desperate for work, soldiers from destroyed Imperiums and fallen empires. Thugs, murderers and dregs from all across the galaxy's underworld, bizarre Xenos breeds from hundreds of different worlds, all were permitted to join, provided they pulled their weight, and made the Freemen a tidy profit. Their equipment was of the highest quality, bought from any Xenos or human empire they could buy from. They became one of the most successful of mercenary brigades across the entire galaxy. Of course, these three are but the tip of the iceberg. Thousands of separate bands and companies sprang up during this period, all hungry to get a share of the undoubtedly lucrative trade of war. For, depressingly, in a universe of such misery and pain, war was the only consistent franchise left. Section 13 The Wolf Lords. You think we're finished, we are the hounds. The very hounds of the Emperor. Of Russ. You think you've won? I disagree. Reputed Vox message from the Wolf Lord Ethelert, from the battle barge Fenric. Before the boarding of the demon vessel Horriblix. The second age of strife affected every chapter of the Angels of Death differently. Some descended into despair-driven barbarity, others broke up into warring factions. Some, like the Imperial Fists, decided to wait out the abomination as we shall see later on. Some lost themselves in their own madness. The Wolves were different. During the unfathomable genocide of the New Devourer, the Space Wolves divided up into their respective companies, and were scattered to every corner of the Imperium, for each great company was self-sufficient, and thus could function in this fractured state. Logan Grimnar, the Great Wolf during the early period, gave his wolves a simple message. Good hunting. Make our deeds legendary and glorious. Die well, my brothers. Die well. Thus, when the Devourer vanished, and the Emperor died, plunging the Imperium into utter chaos, the Space Wolves made good on their instructions. Each Wolf Lord of the 12 Great Company's deeds were legendary. Yet, space is limited, and thus only some of the Wolf Lord's exploits can be properly detailed here. The others are documented elsewhere. Hint. Ethelred, known as the Breaker, feasting upon Fenris upon the death of the Emperor. Thus, he was the Wolf Lord tasked with defending the realm against collapse. He sallied forth from Fenris, flanked by his fleet of warships, and traveled to every world within reach of Fenris. Where worlds descended into anarchy, his wolves would quell the rebellion. Where Xenos reared their foul faces, Ethelred would smash them. Often, when a world fell, the Wolf Lord would challenge their leaders to an honor duel, marching forwards, alone, wielding only his vast mace. Often, a world would surrender, rather than risk dying at his hand. This desperate defense of the suddenly powerless Imperium continued on for many centuries. Demons, monsters and aliens constantly assailed the wolves from every direction. Supplies often became scarce, and many times, the Wolf Lord would order a munitions producing world ransacked for supplies, though, unfortunately, this often ended in butchery due to the heavy-handedness of the wolves. Yet, even though many millions died in the endless wars of this time, the wolves managed to rally the scant few Imperial troops in the sector directly surrounding the Space Wolf homeworld, urging them on to fight for their honor. For the briefest instant, hope flickered anew. Of course, then the Western Chaos Imperium began to advance eastwards, like a vile plague. Two titanic armies surged from the Chaos Imperium. One was led by Abaddon himself, while a second force, led by the Demon Prince Lothar, and the Wolf brother traitor Tosdak. With no astropathic communication, Ethelred could not determine which force would attack first, and from where. He dared not split his forces, for even all 150 of his wolves, backed up by their supporting 100,000 human soldiers, would be horrendously outnumbered by even one of the titanic armies of Chaos. 243, the Demon Prince attacked. The beast led his forces across the northern planets of the fragile Finrisian Imperium, murdering and butchering countless millions as they ravage whole systems. When informed of this by his rune priests, Ethelred ordered his forces north to combat the demonic menace. His fleet surged north, and it was on the world of Stinling that Ethelred engaged the evil Chaos monsters. The forces had not expected the wolves to arrive so swiftly, and the Wolf Lord made a surprise assault upon the demon-infested capital. Battle was joint and fierce. Fallen Wolf brothers, despoiled Arcadians, and Black Legionnaires battled the frenzied wolves and their allied human warriors. Blood mixed with the grey ash and grimy muck of the planet, as limbs were hacked, veins were pierced, and man murdered man with reckless abandon. Many were the legends associated with the battle. On the bridge into the city, a frenzied Khorne berserker blocked all from crossing the bridge. His twin chain glaives were a whirling maelstrom of sawtoothed death. Eventually, he was slain by a cunning Bloodclaw, who clambered underneath the bridge. Scuttling like a beetle, the Bloodclaw managed to plunge his chainsword upwards, hacking through both the berserker's Achilles tendons. As he dropped, the Wolf Priest Jamir charged forwards and dashed the monster's head from his shoulders in one sweep of his blade. Eventually, Ethelred engaged Lothar himself. The vile beast was three times the height of a man, and had grown a vast, twisted wolf's face, in mockery of the space wolves. Ethelred and his long fangs engaged the fiend. As he swept his mace as the beast, the long fangs would pump fire from their heavy weapons, preventing the demon from striking back at the Wolf Lord. Eventually, Ethelred managed to duck beneath the prince's swinging claws, and swung his mace directly into the foul monster's spine, shattering it. The foul thing fought on, wrestling with Ethelred, and nearly savaging his throat with its demonic fangs. Ethelred floundered, and the fight seemed to go from his eyes. Tosdak watched, and he watched, as his Jean brother struggled with the Devil Wolf Prince. He looked upon his former comrade in blood, as his armor was rent and his body was being slashed by ethereal talons. He could watch no more. With a mighty bestial howl, Tosdak charged into the fray, and plunged his ether lance directly through the corrupt demon prince's black heart. As it roared in agony, Lothar swept a monstrous paw at the Wolf brother, decapitating the traitorous Astartes. However, Tosdak had slain the demon prince, and both sides knew this. Ethelred took up his mace, and drew his bolter, and he blasted the foul beast apart, all the while, pulverizing its stagnant flesh with his wolf-headed mace. However, even as it dissolved into warp stuff, Lothar chuckled heinously. He was only the distraction, and Ethelred realized this too late. Fenris was the real target. It had always been the real target. He made all speed back to Fenris. However, Abaddon was already there. Mighty Bjorn had fallen, slain by the coward Abaddon, who had pulverized him from orbit, along with most of the defense force. Ethelred, howling curses, immediately assaulted the Chaos Force. Another brutal, bloody battle took place, upon the rubble of Fenris herself. The stricken and depleted wolves fought like gods of legend, and hacked their way through the great sea of chaotic filth, towards Abaddon. Murder was in the old wolf's eyes. An obliterator scorched his armor with fire and melt a beam, but he pushed on, hacking it down with his mace and his frost blade. Demonically corrupted Calidus lunged forth, hurtling poisonous darts into his flesh, and hacking at his limbs with perfectly murderous strikes. Though his blood was boiling with venom, and his limbs were mangled, He still fought through them, hacking them down in turn. Voltan the Bull Prince, a vast Chaos Lord, charged him, and was butchered in the wild fury of the Space Wolf, who tore out his throat with his long fangs. Eventually, he reached Abaddon himself, and battle was joined. He threw himself onto the Lord of the Chaos Imperium. Bestial Frenzy fought demon-enhanced might, and the two forces paused momentarily, as the battle was joined between the two combatants. However, Abaddon reached out with his talon, and closed it around the Wolf Lord's throat. Abaddon grinned with evil delight, as he imitated his gene father's murder of his own brother, and the memory filled him with glee. Ethelred sank to his knees, choking and spluttering for air which wouldn't come. In one last, defiant strike, he swung his frost blade at his opponent, striking him in the face. The gnashing fangs of the blade tore through skin and flesh, ripping half of Abaddon's face from his corrupt skull. He howled in agony, hacking off the Wolf Lord's arm with his demon sword, before plunging it deep into his body. Then, and only then, did Ethelred die, his soul roasted by infernal energies. Yet, inspired by his example, the wolves threw themselves upon the Chaos forces, reaping a horrendous toll on the Chaos Imperium's forces. Though they died to a man, the space wolves of Ethelred's great company took down over 12 million enemy soldiers. So depleted was the Chaos force, that Abaddon had to return to his own lands, to replenish his numbers. Thus, the sacrifice of the wolves of Ethelred bought the survival of Fenris, and the last survivor, the cunning Bloodclaw who helped slay the Berserker, kept the demoralized human population of the Fenrisian Imperium alive, by moving between each world, telling tales of the ancient space wolves. Their sacrifice would save the Fenrisian Imperium from collapse. Grimnir, upon the death of the Emperor, was already leading his great company against the new Devourer, and had only just survived the foul horde. Though the new Devourer was vanquished, the space wolves of his company were depleted to only 50 marines. He determined, nevertheless, that he would perform great deeds, worthy of the grandest of songs. Thus, his fleet went off on another great hunt. As their fleet prowled the void, it became apparent they were far from the Imperium. Their navigator was lost, claiming the Emperor's light was gone, Grimnir nearly killing him for even suggesting it, and thus no maps could be made. Every world they encountered, as they short warp jumped between systems, were filled with demons and monsters, ruled by hideous alien beasts, or were completely barren, picked clean by the new Devourer. Those forces he could combat, he slew with great fury. Those too powerful for his fleet, were left alone, but Grimnir promised he would find them each in turn, another day, and there he would slay them. However, one world could not be left alone, the foul library of coin. Terrified merchants and cowering human vessels, captured by the wolves, claimed that foul, forbidden knowledge was being researched upon the world, and that the world was building vast libraries across its entire surface. A silver-tongued man, calling himself Mephit, even told the wolves he knew the way to the planet, and he led them there. Grimnir knew who ruled coin, even before he entered the system. 6 months later, the glass spires, the vast libraries. The cold blue and gold sentinels, guarding each temple library. The thousand suns yet lived. The great Wolf could not spare these ancient traitors. Thus, the space wolves, following a bombardment of the glass cities of Coin, made planetfall in great fury. When they landed, they realized something terrible. Beneath the shattered glass towers, vast metal ones reared, glimmering with internal verity's flame. The very ground of Coin was silver and hard, covered in complex glyphs and symbols. In orbit, Mephit's mocking laugh echoed across every voxlink. For Coin was not the domain of the Thousand Suns, but had an altogether more powerful patron. Coin was a trap, to ensnare the space wolves. As the Deceiver destroyed the orbiting battle barges and strike cruisers, using his powerful silver vessels, which entered the system instantaneously, the Deceiver offered his term. He wanted Grimnir and his marines alive. Legend does not tell us what the Stug God desired. Some claim he wanted more Kay, the axe, for some evil ritual. Others said there was something in the blood of the space wolves that the Golden Abomination craved. Some theories, rather more far-fetched and outlandish, claim that the Deceiver wished to use the wolves as bait, to ensnare the sorcerer Ahriman, in order for the Cetan to gain access to the Webway, and hence engage Segarach directly. Who knows? All we know is that Grimnir, honorable as he was, refused, spitting in defiance, and planting his banner in the metal soil of Coin. He would not yield. For months, the Necrons assailed the wolves, and each time they were pushed back, at a dreadful cost. By the fourth month of the war, only 20 Marines still lived, led by the bedraggled and increasingly insane Grimnir. Each death came as a personal blow to the old Wolf, and each time, he lost a little of his own mind. After every battle, the Deceiver would speak psychically to him and offer him release if he would only give in to the Deceiver's demands. Every time, bleary-eyed and sorrowful, he would curse the Stur God and refuse. At the height of the final month, the Wolves, holed up in one of the tall silver tomb towers, desperately fought off waves of immortal death machines. Every time the beasts died, they would rise up and knit back together. Only the plasma weapons remaining permanently took down the silver sentinels, causing them to vanish from sight. It seemed as though the five remaining space wolves would be utterly exterminated by the Deceiver's hordes, when help came from a most unwelcome place. Within the cold dark chamber, a great fiery rent ruptured the air, and from the blazing chaos, stepped three Marines. Two were clad in grey, and marked power armor, with every chapter affiliation carefully filed off. They stood silent, bolters across their chests. The third Marine was different, and the hairs on the space wolves' necks raised, and they snarled fiercely at the newcomer. Four, standing before them, was a Marine clad in the colors of the Dark Angels, the ancient rivals of the Wolves of Rus. The Marine's twin pistols were sheathed, and his hands were raised in a placating manner. Grimnir snarled, decrying the Dark Angel. He responded calmly, by offering the wolves passage from the world. All they had to do was go through the portal. After much deliberation, they reluctantly agreed. However, before they could leave, Necrons began to shimmer into existence from thin air, azure weapons crackling with infernal energies. Heroically, Grimnir ordered his wolves to go through the portal, while he held the Necrons off. As they fled, Grimnir tossed Morkay to his second-in-command, Longfang Bryanison, and the Longfang tossed his leader his own frost blade in exchange. "I'll be wanting that back later," were the last known words of Logan Grimnir, before he charged, alone, into the Silver Horde, bellowing curses and oaths. No one knows what happened to him, as he was never seen again. All the Space Wolves know is that he no doubt reaped a great toll amongst his unloving foes. Some claim he fought the Deceiver itself, but no one can ever be certain. Nevertheless, his ballad is sung by the various beleaguered little pockets of Space Wolf resistance across the galaxy to this day. Of course, these are but a few of the tales of the great companies. The exploits of Ragnar the Black Main 1, the final charge of Wolf Lord Voster, the Dread 13th Company, and all the other companies, have their own tales of honor and sacrifice. Each force desperately fighting in the last dying hope of an already festering corpse. The Space Wolves, scattered across the entire galaxy, knew they would likely die. However, they would not go quietly into oblivion. They would fight, for they were the Hounds of the Emperor. Of Rus. Then the returned Great Wolf came for the Wolf time, Rus surged forward to the head of the Deceiver. Section 14 The Starfather Incarnate. By the dawn of the 50th millennium, almost 8,000 years since the death of the Emperor, the galaxy was like a shattered mosaic. Thousands of Imperiums, of differing creeds, beliefs, and ever technology, were spread across light years, each weak and alone, compared to the glory of the old days long since past. Aliens and madmen dominated worlds, and countless corpses of worlds devoured or scoured clean by war, lay scattered across every corner of the galactic disk. There was no rule, no law, no mercy. And, amid all this carnage and mayhem, one thing never changed. The blind, desperate devotion of the masses, as they prayed and begged the dead Emperor to save their souls from this galactic anarchy. Blood was sacrificed, people denounced neighbors, friends, children, to the roving witch hunters and lunatics, who eagerly brutalized and slaughtered those sacrifices in wild religious glee, which became a near constant feature of the dreadful Aphelion Imperium. The majority of humanity were crying out for order, for protection. On 000M50, they received their wishes, their prayers. And they regretted it, with all their putrid hearts. As, on that day, the Star Child, fermenting in the womb of the immaterial, was born. To define the origins of this Star Child, we must look to the Horus Heresy, so many millennia ago. In the instant the Emperor struck down his Jean son, all his goodwill and benevolence was driven from him, into the ether, leaving only a bitter, dying husk of cold oppression. This husk was placed onto the Golden Throne, thus sealing the warp from terror and keeping him alive. Yet, the throne's purpose went beyond this. This throne was once fashioned to help draw in all knowledge of the universe, drawn from the immaterial. And so it continued to do so, For thousands upon thousands of years, the misery of the galaxy, the heartache and the desperate pleas for protection and submissive pleas for oppression, filled the Emperor's mind. Every event, every death, resonated within the Emperor's mind. Every senseless murder, every despairing tear of a bereaved mother, screaming out for someone to save them, pulsed through the throne, even as millions of sickers were fed into the Emperor. Amplifying and intensifying these thoughts of anguish and misery, it drove him utterly, irreversibly, insane. Trapped inside his own corpse, he screamed silently, though no one could hear him, and those that could were mad zealots themselves, and could not understand his babbled, confused words. All the while, in the warp, the star child grew and matured, as yet unborn, but waiting for its moment. The star child was a being formed from the most seemingly positive of emotions possible, compassion, and the will to protect everyone. Of course, fed and nourished within the warp, these emotions were twisted and stretched to gargantuan and monstrous proportions. The star child became fed upon all forms of protection, and this protection was taken to its extreme. To protect everyone, repression and domination was required, and these emotions fed into one another until they were as one. Compassion turned to jealous love. In the twisted aspect of the star child, love for humanity was love for the star child, and no other. It became a dark and dreadful force, lurking in the hidden folds of the warp, waiting. It was not until the 42nd millennium that these two forces, one of utter oppression, the other a cold being, fed upon slaughter and murderous sacrifice, would merge once more. When the Emperor, strapped to his chair, looked into the cold eyes of his killer, swathed in a deep hood, he did not resist him, but merely muttered, as the blade was poised over his heart. End this. Terra fell to chaos, but the great spirit of sacrifice surged free, into the warp, and the waiting coils of its counterpart. It took mere instants within the warp, as the two great energies fused and molded into something far, far worse than the sum of its parts. In the Materium, this fusing took thousands of years, the Imperium shattering and the galaxy falling apart in the meantime. The birth, and like the birth of Slaanesh, was not some great spilling warp storm explosion, but rather a mighty implosion. Centered around Aphelia, the dark heart of the Emperor's bloody worship, space rippled, as Aphelia was swallowed whole by the warp storm, before warp space merely returned to normality, leaving the Aphelian Imperium without a capital world. It survived barely, but Talon took advantage, but that is a separate tale. Warp storms suddenly flared into life, galaxy-wide, as the entire galaxy felt something. It was as if two ocean behemoths fought beneath the waves of a great sea, and caused the boats above to toss and turn as a result. The Chaos Gods, that great behemoth, wrestled with this sudden resurgent force for order. No one could possibly describe the conflict, because, in effect, it was not a conflict in any conceptual sense. Realms overlapped, folded inwards, cursed and shifted into different emotional states, and reason and lunacy sifted and pulped emotions of befuddlement and anguish, and despair and murderous lust. As the warp churned as never before, Murgle seized upon the empathetic despair of the Emperor aspect, but was twisted off course by the hope of dominion and protection, which was surrounded by the hope for more hope, and the urge for change. Demons, whose concepts and feeding emotions switched sides as much as their patrons, flickered between devil and ordered angel, as the great game played out, confusing and insane as the warp ever was. Yet, the warp was as much a process as a distinct entity, or entities, and, like always, the process was the same. The Star Child rose up, and the Chaos Gods nominally united against it, overthrowing it at some point amongst the non-causal realm of mind-numbing density and dreadful insanity. After the overthrow of the Star Child, Nurgle rose in its place, only for the Star Child to unite, however fractionally, with the other gods, in overthrowing Nurgle. And hence, the great game continued, as it ever had. It became one of five main facets of the warp. Of course, in the Materium, the Star Child or Star Father as it became known made itself felt far more profoundly. The Star Father's influence was almost as insidious as the Chaos Gods. Tendrils of essence would infest the minds of the rulers and devout priests of a world. They only wanted to protect their flock, as the Emperor had wished. The cold, commanding voice of the Star Father seemed to whisper and bellow in their minds at once. To protect, one must enslave. But more than enslave. Dominate entirely. Thus, a web of influence spread across the whole world, unseen but powerful beyond measure. Priests and preachers performed sermons, which opened up people to the possibility of the ultimate piety. Chaos with emotions, the sick twisted emotions at the heart of sentience. To remove thought of chaos, one must remove thought. Unconsciousness and servitude eternal was the only fully secure protection from chaotic corruption. Thus, they all, slowly, began to come around to this way of thinking. Those that didn't, were sacrificed in the name of submission to him, to the Star Father, the great patriarch of all existence in their minds. All the while, they were the ones corrupted, as they sacrificed more souls to the Star Father, until it was powerful enough to break down the barriers of reality, and allow his demons, which we shall refer to as angels from now on, just to differentiate these from demons, or spirits of chaos, to walk upon the surface. By that time, the world was entranced by these angels, who set about reshaping the world. Buildings melted down, and reformed, as uniform, silver and gold monuments to the Star Father, while the population was forced to walk across the surface of the world for the rest of their lives. For no particular reason, however, should any of them leave the perfectly straight lines marked out for their walks, they would be instantly destroyed, and their souls dragged into the warp. Men, women and children walked and walked, until they could no longer walk. These people were then either killed, or died of exhaustion. Such was the way of the Star Father. Worlds such as these, sprang up across the galaxy, especially around worlds where devotion to the Emperor had become completely senseless. Unlike demon worlds, angel worlds becalmed the warp directly around the world, rather than churning it. These were worlds of horrifying, self-defeating order. The Sensei, the progeny of the Emperor, managed to, for the most part, resist domination. Their tragic stories are told elsewhere though, so we will not dwell upon it here. The angels, the dread avatars of his will, were powerful and as cold as their master. Faceless, the most common form of the angels was of winged beings, with androgynous, silver and gold shapes, neither man, woman, or any other natural form. Dozens of wings arched from them, each devastating and bladed, and the long, blank faces protruded from within these wings. They blazed permanently with intense white light, and left trails of sparks behind them, as they floated ethereally wherever they went. Some say the angels are formed from the spirits of all those astropaths, soul bound to the Emperor while still clothed in flesh. None can prove this, but the theory is prevalent. Of the greater angels, only one is known to have a name, and a face. The Malkada, the Great Dominion. The Great Dominion has a harsh, stern, humanoid face, amidst all the folding robes and razor-edge wings. It is the greatest of them all, the first soul bound to the Star Father, so long ago. It is often the voice of its patron during wars, and he only ever offers one option to those enemies of the Star Father. Obey. 4. In the grim nightmare of the 51st millennium, there is no righteous or good path. That was murdered, along with the Emperor, long ago. Tyranny, oppression, or anarchy and doom, are the only options left to the faithful. All is dust, and there is no salvation. Of course, the above statement isn't quite accurate. If you haven't already, check out my Redbubble portfolio, you might just find something you like.
Just stop! Just stop it! Stop! No! Just stop it! It's time to stop! It's time to stop, okay? No more! Where the fuck are your parents? Who are your parents? I'm gonna call Child Protective Services! It's time to stop!